Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath to you all. I can't hear you. Come on. We should be celebrating on this day, right? Happy Sabbath to everyone. Happy Sabbath. Amen. Amen. On behalf of the Family Life Ministries Department, we're here to promote some of the initiatives that will happen this year. But we want to tell you a little bit about Family Life Department. When we reflect on the family, we realize that it was in God's design from the beginning of time. We appreciate that the family is at the center of God's plan for contentment, enjoyment, fulfillment, learning, growth, and progress. One writer stated, "The family is the ordained place where human beings can experience love to its fullest extent, romantic love, friendship love, and redemptive love. In our church, we endeavor to support one another for our needs and to uplift when we need uplifting. At home, family worship should be the core of our family time. It provides the opportunity to commune with God and to learn from each other and to also uplift one another."
One author stated that families should utilize prayer time as a way to transmit religious traditions to the younger generations. Ellen White speaks to us of how crucial the need for family prayer is. She said, "Every family should rear its altar of prayer, realizing that the fear of the Lord is a beginning of wisdom." Family life and the act of praying and worshiping together should allow family members to build relationships and have unity and growth. For this to be realized, the members of the family need to live a life that honors God.
When problems arise in the home, don't worry, don't fret, because we the church here as a family are here to provide resources to assist you with your challenges. The Family Life Department is available to provide teaching, training, and counseling from our pastors and certified psychologists, equipping families with the tools necessary to grow closer together, closer to your spouse, closer to your children, and God. On behalf of the Family Life Department, please remember that for the family to grow and exist in unity, it needs God at the center.
Amen.
We now have some, I'm going to explain the mission statement to you, and after that, you will hear some of our initiatives for this year. Our mission statement states, to reach, equip, and empower all families with hope and wholeness. Our goal for these 2 years are evangelism and community engagement. The text that we will focus on, the latter part of it, says, "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Amen? Amen. Here are some of our initiatives. On February 24th, which is next week, our Women's Ministry Director, Patricia Ferreira Lopez, will be here as our main speaker. And after the Divine Hour, we'll have a roundtable session on the topic Saul's Sisters. Who are Saul's sisters, you may ask? Our director is encouraging as many ladies, young and old, to come out to find out what Saul's sister is all about. We will have a small potluck, and then we'll start the seminar.
Okay, on the same Sabbath, February 24th, the men will also host a round table on how to communicate with adult children. Whether you are an adult child or a person who has adult children, we encourage all to come to eat, and then discuss challenges and strategies that we may need for communication with our children. There will be a joint potluck with the woman before the seminar. Then on March 10th, okay, that's the 2 weeks after, we'll have our first broken relationship seminar. Pastor Julio Davila from the Alberta SDA Conference will be our facilitator. This will be comprised of three sessions. Sunday, March 10th at 12 p.m., Sunday, March 17th, also at 12 p.m., and Sunday, April 14th at 2 p.m., at 12 p.m. We encourage everyone to sign up for the seminar. Okay, sign-up sheets are available for everyone to come sign up. Okay, all right.
So the sign-up sheets are outside, and after the service, I'm encouraging everyone to go over to the booth and just to sign up for this initiative. So on behalf of the Family Life Department, we encourage everyone to come out and support these initiatives because you know what? You will be blessed. Let's pray. Heavenly Father and our God, we thank you for reminding us that the family was in your divine design. Some families are in disarray at this moment as I'm praying to you. Some members of the family are experiencing hurt and some are experiencing pain. Some of our family members are visibly broken. Some are happy at this time, but some of those brokenness are hidden. Some families are suffering and some are joyful. Whatever the situation, the broken and the unbroken, we now give you the baton, Lord, to increase your presence in each of our families, each of our homes, each of our lives, and bring change, bring unity, and hope to all. We thank you, Father Lord. Amen and amen.
Do you know someone who is open to the truth? Do you wish you could introduce them to Jesus in a non-judgmental, no pressure, non-threatening way, but you aren't sure how to do it? Well, beginning March 1st, Hope Channel Canada and its diverse media ministries will offer programs that fit the needs of people from all walks of life. The perfect place to point that person whose heart yearns for more. Through Hope Channel Canada, we can share that there is more to life, and it's found in Jesus. So I encourage you to share with that person who is open to the truth that a new hope is coming to Canada. Watch shows with them on the web, on cable, through the mobile app, and through Roku. Pray for them as they open themselves to Jesus. And please, help make this ministry in Canada possible by becoming an agent of hope today.
As the praise team comes up, let us stand for our opening hymn.
Let us march on to victory is won. Slowly the road we trod, better the chastening rod, felt in the days when more unborn had died, yet with a steady beat had not a weary feet come to the place for which our people sigh. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered. Out from the
places our God where we met thee. Lest our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, be forsaken thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand. God, true to our name.
Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to come into this place tonight to worship you, to praise you through song, through spoken word, to rejoice together and to bring our needs to each other and to you, Lord. We pray that your Holy Spirit would dwell among us today, empowering us and uplifting our spirits. We pray these things in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen. As is tradition in this church, we like to get up out of our seats before the praise set starts and have a round of greetings. So let's get up out of our seats and greet people.
God is so good.
God is so good.
God is so good.
Amen. Just a reminder that we have a special program for the kids in the gym. So if you have your kids worshiping with us, they have a special program for them in the gym. So feel free to take them over, send them to the gym. Amen.
Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? You know, I've had not the best week. I got sick this week, and I'm just recovering now, but there's power in the blood, amen? Let's sing this morning.
Like a one.
At this time, we're going to sing our theme song for the month of February, Heirs of the Father. Now to come to the Garden of Prayer. If you have wants on your heart, needs, burdens that you wish to bring to the Lord, come forward now.
Oh, Our Father in heaven, this morning we have come together as a church to give thanks for all of those things which you have done for each of us. The blessings of life that bring happiness into our existence. Thank you, Father, for this family of believers who support each other in and through our trials and our lives. And thank you for sending Jesus to this world to redeem us and to open the door to a better world, a better life. That though we may face many trials in this world, we have that assurance of an eternal future. We know that where two or more are gathered in Jesus' name, that he is present. And so we come to lay before you those trials and difficulties which are heaviest on our hearts. They may take the form of sickness, or they may be relationship problems within families. Some may have financial troubles. Others may be troubled by spiritual issues. But whatever the situation, Lord, we ask as we pause now for a minute of silent prayer that you hear each prayer, each burdened heart, and that you respond accordingly, according to your will. Father, thank you for hearing our prayers, the prayers of each person here today. We ask also that the Holy Spirit be present as we worship, to lead us into truth as we study your word. May the pastor's message especially be the message that you wish us to hear today as we consecrate our lives to the work that you have given us. May your Spirit daily bring about changes in us, that we can more fully reflect the light of your presence in a world which seems to grow darker every day. Strengthen our faith, Father, and may we always walk with you. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Good morning, church. I just wanted to draw your attention to a couple announcements, number two and number three on your announcements in your bulletin. As you may notice, we have just recently purchased an AED or defibrillator in case of emergency. It's being installed according to code and being registered with the proper authorities. We just need to know who in the church is certified to operate an AED or being trained. If you can just raise your hand, just kind of get an idea. I don't see hands, very many hands here. Oh, there we go, there are quite a few. Please, if you can just let us know by just letting the church clerk know, just email the church clerk with your name and email, and we can then forward a video. Every AED is very similar. It's a basic structure, but it might have some little intricacies that you should be aware of. So we can forward you a video of just exactly what kind of AED we have. It does have children pads as well as an adult pad. The adult pads are already installed. Children pads are available in the box as well. It is technically a secure box. It doesn't have to be broken or anything. It has an alarm on it if it needs to be opened and has to be checked and so forth, but we'll take care of that. But if you just please email your information to the church clerk. The church clerk's email is right on the back of the bulletin, and it is there for you to email that to. The other issue is that number three on the list here is health professionals. The Ontario Conference is requesting a list of all active or retired health professionals. If you are one, whether you be a physiotherapist, nutritionist, nurse, doctor, dental assistant, et cetera, if you can please email your name to the church clerk so we can forward that to the Ontario Conference. I'm not sure exactly what they're going to be using that for, but I think it's basically to know what our resources are. Thank you very much.
Good morning, Church. Little things makes a house home. Likewise, many minds, organizations in our church, they're making and organizing, having this lighting here, and the paper towels, the vacuuming, everything in its place. 2 days, all for offering claims for our local church budget so that we all can come here, make this place a living place to worship our Savior. So we not to do all this, we need a budget. So today's offering directly goes to our local church budget. That's why I want you to refer to the last book of Old Testament, that 39th book, it's called Malachi, chapter 3, verse 1. Start with a question. Can anybody rob God? Yes, you can rob with tithes and offerings. But I am so interested in the verse 10, Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. God so clearly, precisely, with a content message in a layman's language, he speaks to us. Bring forth the tenth portion of your earnings to me so that there will be food in my storehouse, the church. And you test me. It's a challenge. Tagged with a blessing. You test me in this. I will open up the windows of heaven and pour out all the blessings you need. And NIV translation says, all the good needs you need. Amen? Take a moment and look at yourself and thank God with an attitude of gratitude for all God's glory that has showered upon you. Brought you from the verge of death to the verge of living to praise Him. With these thoughts in mind, I want you to understand, can we outgive God? The more you give, the more you receive. With this being said, I request the deacons to come forward to collect God's tithes and our offerings today, especially to our local church budget, so that you will be blessed. How? Ask anything you give, ask me, I'll give it to you. And I also ask the children, little children, to come. They are going to come for the lamb's offering for our local church school. So whatever God says to you at this moment, give it gladly, because you will be receiving. You cannot outgive God. Let us pray. Almighty eternal heavenly Father, we thy children come to your presence to seek your blessings, Lord. Bless every member, every individual here, as they are going to bring the little portion of their blessings to you, Lord. Bless it. And utilize it for your honor and glory so that we can reach out the unreached and bring many, many souls closer to you. These few blessings, I ask it in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Meet Anthony, a dedicated father who, like thousands of Christian parents, experienced the same heartache. His three adult children had drifted away from the church. Already living with their own families, they showed no desire to attend the services. To the discomfort of their children, Anthony constantly invited them to church and persistently talked about the perils of being far from God. They kindly asked their father to stop inviting them to church. Anthony intensified the prayers for his children. While praying for them one morning, a particular scripture crossed his mind. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The more he prayed, the more that verse resonated with him. Anthony made a bold decision. During a family meeting, he informed his children that he would grant their request and no longer insist that they return to the church. But there was a condition. They would return their tithes and offerings to God. Surprisingly, the children accepted the agreement, thinking they would no longer be bothered with invitations to the church. But in time, something extraordinary happened. Anthony had the privilege of witnessing his three children return to the church. In the context of tithes and offerings, Ellen G. White says, "There has been a great neglect on the part of parents in not seeking to interest their children in the workings of the cause of God." And she continues by saying that in many families, children seem to be left out of the question as if they were irresponsible beings. As we look to protect the hearts of our children, let us motivate them to put God and His cause first. Let us invite them fervently to return their tithes and promise offerings to the Lord. If their treasures are in heaven, we may be sure that there their hearts will also be. May we put our desires last and God first.
Good morning, church. It is indeed a blessing to be in the courts of God. Just want to, as I sing this song, I want you to listen to the words of the song more than you do to my voice, because the words are actually God's words coming to us.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Luke 15, 11 to 24. As is our custom, let us stand as we read the scripture. These are the words of Jesus. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me a share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed his pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer to be worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate." May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Wonder how it makes you feel when the prodigal won't come home. I wonder how it makes you feel when he'd rather be on his own. I wonder what it's like for you when a lamb has gone astray. I wonder what it's like for you when your children disobey. It must be like another thorn stuck in your brow. It must be like another close friend's broken vow. It must be like another net through your wrist. It must be just like Judas kissed. I wonder how it makes you feel when no one seeks your face. I wonder how it makes you feel when they give up in the race. I wonder what it's like for you when they willingly disobey. I wonder what it's like for you when they willingly walk away. It must be like another thorn stuck in your brow. just be just like Judas kiss.
Thank you, Samuel, Jonathan, and Dean, for doing this song. Friends, I've sent a comment to our music team saying, I always dreamt as a pastor to pastor a church where we have a superb music and praise team, amen? Where the music is not just showing up on Sabbath and picking random songs and just saying, let's play this today. But where a lot of heart goes into preparation, and a lot of heart goes in praying that the Spirit would be leading. Now, I've started presenting a special Pathfinder's honor to our kids. And this honor was introduced recently in 2023. So I made a deal with them. If you could recognize and tell me the three faces on that patch, you got the honor. Anyone ready here to recognize these three of our many, many pioneer women? Now, I'm asking you, you're reflecting on this. Pathfinders, they listen, they know already. Many of us don't realize that at the beginning of our movement, our church was literally run by women. Not hearing amen in the house. You don't have to say amen only when Caribbean preacher is speaking. Our church was pioneered and run by women at the beginning. In fact, it was conservative, fundamentalist, chauvinistic movement in 1930s that relegated women to home. That cult of domesticity hit our church hard about 90 years ago, and we're still recovering from it. One of the pioneers in that movement was this woman, Sarepta Miranda Irish Henry, born Irish, nee Irish. She was born to a Methodist minister of quite significant prominence. Her brother, and I need to look up his name because he never became Adventist, Erasmus Irish, served in United States government. Just to mention two positions that he held under President Abraham Lincoln, he was the superintendent of Indian affairs for the state of Utah. And under President Garfield, he was the chief of the Bureau of Engraving and Printing. Now, do you understand what that bureau does? Prints money. So just to give you the significance of this family, she was married and her husband passed at an early age. And as a mother, she was troubled because her son, Arthur, has been lured into saloon. Now, back in those days, saloon was like a combination of a nightclub and drug place and whatever. And so she got involved in women's temperance movement. That was becoming popular in those days. She actually became a national evangelist for the Women's Christian Temperance Union, and soon she became a convert to Seventh-day Adventist Church. She pioneered women's ministry in our church. But in one of her preaching seasons, as she preached to mothers about importance of praying for our children, a distraught mother came forward and asked her this question: if God answers prayers, then why does my son, for whom I've prayed so much, lies in a drunkard's grave? It hit Sarepta really hard. She ended up writing this book, The Unanswered Prayer, or Why Do So Many Children of the Church Go to Ruin? To paraphrase today, what if the prodigals do not come home? I want you to think on that. We're worshiping today, and it is great to see people, those we pray for, coming. But what if prodigals do not come home? You heard the song right now, and it's a beautiful song. I wanted to repeat those verses again for you. This is pondering how God feels when we, the prodigals, are not turning to Him. I wonder how it makes Christ feels when we would rather be on our own, when He's knocking on the doors of our heart and we're saying, leave me alone. I wonder how we make God feel when we willingly disobey, when we go astray willingly. And let's be honest, many of us do it willingly. The chorus is even more beautiful because it reminds us that we're offending Jesus afresh. In Hebrews chapter 6, it says, when we willingly disobey, when we have tasted the goodness of God and go on willfully sinning, we're crucifying Jesus afresh. It must be like another thorn stuck in your brow. It must be like another close friend's broken vow. I tell you, nothing hurts more than betrayal within the family. When those you love and trust and expect to have your back betray the promise. It must be like another nail right through your wrist. It must be just like Judas' kiss. The second stanza's perspective is closer to God's heart. And I tell you why, because we all are lost children to God. Lost in the need of a Savior, and I'm emphasizing all, because there's not a single righteous in here. No matter elder, deacon, whatever position you hold, we are lost children in the need of God. And I'm going to stress this over and over, that none of us get an idea somehow that I'm better than another. Because a lot of strife in family, a lot of strife in relationship comes from that competition of one assuming that somehow he or she is better than another. And so the second stanza says, I wonder how it makes you feel when no one seeks your face. I wonder how it makes you feel when they give up in the race. I wonder what it's like for you when they willingly disobey, when they willingly walk away. Do you see God's face? Do you seek to see His face? You know, recently I made a discovery that prodigal does not mean what I thought it means. Now, track with me. If you go to Luke chapter 15, there's three parables there, right? We all know the first parable, the parable of the lost sheep. Then there's a second parable, the parable of the lost coin. And then comes the third parable, parable of the lost son. The question is, which son is truly lost? I want you to reflect on that as we get into the parable. And so the parables are about lostness. But then somehow English translators decided that they're going to add word prodigal into one of the titles, and it says the parable of the prodigal son. Now, over a decade ago, I picked up a book by a famous preacher, Timothy Keller, working in New York City. He has passed away recently, a great preacher. And his book was called Prodigal God. Now you realize it triggered my attention. What do you mean, prodigal God? How could you say God is prodigal? The son is prodigal. So I picked up the book and I realized I don't know English as well as I should. Do you know what word prodigal means? I love prodigal God because word prodigal means spending resources freely, wastefully, extravagantly. Isn't our God spending on us unnecessary with extravagance? Do we deserve any of what we get? And yet he gives over and above what we could ever, ever deserve. Prodigal means having and giving something on a lavish scale, being generous. When I read that, I said, God, I want to be prodigal father. I hope my kids said, our dad is prodigal. And don't judge me if you think I'm being lavish and generous on my kids, whatever I can, because God has placed that responsibility in my life. Notice how the parable begins. Chapter 15 in verse 2 starts with this accusation. The Pharisees and scribes, all the religious authorities, were complaining, saying, this guy sits with sinners and eats meals with them, treating them like friends. It's their grumbling that triggered Jesus to tell these stories. And so lost sheep story is very short, straightforward. There's nothing to talk about. There's an immature person who goes astray, and it's your duty to go and grab hold of them and bring them back in a fold. So church family, simply family. When you see someone as a family member because of their immaturity doing stupid things, what is your duty? Go grab hold of them and bring them back in a fold. Even if they kick a bit, that's your duty. Then there's a second story of the lost coin. And that's an interesting because it's a short story of celebration when someone was unnoticed and now is put in a spotlight. It's in this parable that we read that God throws party in heaven and angels celebrate when every lost soul is noticed. And I'm thinking there are people in church, there are people in family, in the company of friends who go unnoticed, unappreciated, displaced, and sometimes they feel that they've been in the wrong place in the wrong time or born in the wrong era. You ever felt that way? This parable is about the rest of the family taking a note of people who've been unappreciated. But here comes the third parable, and this is the most interesting. In my Bible, I think I should better retitle it and call it Prodigal Parable of Lost Sons, plural. And you would understand why. Look with me in the parable that was so well read by Dr. Castella. Thank you for that reading. I hope your Bibles are open, Luke 15. Because I want you to see some details that we usually miss. The son comes, in verse 12, and said, Father, give the portion of goods that belong to me. Now, here's an interesting request, and let me clear this to you, because in Middle East, the older son inherits double portion. The next son just inherits his portion. So the younger son comes and says, Dad, even though you're still alive, I want to get my portion. Dad, I know you've got a big bank account. I don't want to wait for you to die. I want you to apportion to me that one-third that belongs to me. Is it a fair request? Many people in the house saying, yeah, why not, right? Why do we have to see all these old geriatric people driving nice cars and we teenagers are struggling? Am I being pushy a bit? Well, that's what he's saying, Dad, I want my portion now. I want to enjoy my life right now. How much is he expecting? One-third. Notice what the father does. So he divided to them his livelihood. In the original, the emphasis is he split in half. He split 50-50 and gave him half. Do you understand why the father is prodigal? The son, in all his audacity, is expecting one-third and father giving him half. In fact, you understand now why the older brother is upset, because the older brother is expecting what? Two-thirds. When father finally passes, the older brother gets two-thirds, and now the father is taking a portion of his belonging and giving it to this younger son. Notice the younger son does not leave right away. Look at the Bible story. Not many days after. That means he stayed at home for a while, getting in his brother's face that I've got my money now and you have to wait. You see, he's staying home. He's not leaving yet. He will leave eventually. And while living home, he's got this attitude. He's not contributing to paying the upkeep of the facilities. He's living for himself. Now, I don't know if you've got anyone in your family who's so selfish that all they think is about themselves. I don't know, like labeling in the fridge on a special shelf that this is mine, I bought it. Not in this church, amen to that. We're all generous and sharing people. But he is still living in the house. And then finally he decides to go. And as he goes, the depression begins. Economic downfall is going down. And you read the story that you could relate to, just like right now, financial situation is not the best. Many teenagers are nervous about leaving home, but he left because he got a big fat bank account, not thinking that he's going to spend it quickly. You know, when I look at that story, there's one more significant word. That word livelihood in Greek is bios, from which we have word life. Father technically took his livelihood, gave his life to him, and he walks away. The youngest son asked his father to tear his life apart. Life, as it was designed, stopped right there. But the father continued loving. Father, knowing that it will be wasted, father still gave the money. So who's the prodigal in this story, friends? The father is fully prodigal. I'm emphasizing this because I want you to grasp the full meaning of this parable for the minds of Jesus' listeners. You know, we want to protect our kids. And I've met all kinds of families. I met families where mom and dad insist that even though their grown-up, mature kid is working and making money, they insist that they would still turn money to them for their control. Is that the right thing to do? Now, I read in the Adventist home in my younger years when my kids were still little that if we as parents don't teach them their financial responsibility, they would not learn it in time. And Ellen White actually advises that we give our kids allowance, and that's not like a dollar on Sabbath morning to put in a plate. No, to give them real allowance that they would learn at a young age to be responsible for themselves. And I told you the story. When I read that in the Adventist home, I said to my wife, we still had some debts to pay. I said, listen, we're getting these CTBs, child tax benefits, and at that time we're getting $480. I feel convicted that we're going to give them to our kids. Quiet in the house? I know children's church today is across there, so maybe the parents who need to hear it are not here. Now, that was not an easy decision, but we did it. And I tell you, it changed our family life forever. Because next time we're in the store in the mall, instead of saying, Daddy, Daddy, buy me this, guess what I'm gonna say? You've got your money. You want to buy it? You've got your money. Now he's going to think twice. He's going to think, well, maybe I need to wait 3 months to get my second and third allowance to get that. You see, they start learning. I could tell you stories of how that impacted our family life. But I wonder, sometimes in our controlling narcissistic attitude, thinking we're protecting our children, we're actually protecting our own exposure to liabilities in the future. Do I need to repeat it or you got it? Because father, knowing that he will spend it all, you know what he did? He gave. Because sometimes the only way we learn is by hitting rock bottom. And that's the picture of God. Notice, he does not run after him. He does not try to prevent him from spending it. He's allowing him to hit the rock bottom. How's that for a picture of God? God who loves us so much that gives us freedom to hurt ourselves and to mess our lives, that when we realize how good God is, when we come back to him, we'll never look back. Would never wonder that maybe I missed something in the world. And that's what happens here. So when son finally hits that rock bottom, he decides to come home. Now, read something interesting. Verse 19. In his mind, when he comes to the father, he's going to make this speech. He's going to say, Dad, let me be like one of your hired servants. You see, this is work-oriented repentance. Because in that economy, people who worked for lords, they still had their own household and their home and their land and everything. And so they would live there. So he's saying basically, Dad, I understand that I messed up so much that I cannot live with you on our estate because I wasted it. But allow me to be one of the hired men who lives in a village who comes and works for you. So in essence, he's saying, let me pay back with working what I did wrong. We don't know his repentance, but his mind is not in the right place. Does God care if our repentance is sincere enough? Or does he care simply that we turn around and start moving in his direction? I want you to understand this. Sometimes we are so judgmental that we want to analyze and judge people to see if their repentance is sincere enough. And all that God cares about is, are you turning your face to me? Now, I'm not talking to anyone in person here, but I know for a fact that we don't trust people. When someone comes repentant, we have all kind of questions. We feel like saying, you know, prove yourself. We're going to watch for a year or for half a year or how long we said those things. You know, you have to prove. I'm speaking for myself. What does God do? Tell us about this father who runs. Now, that's another story. In Greek, he's not just running leisurely. He sprints. And he gets to his son before the stones do. Now, you get what I'm talking about. See, it was written in the law that in the village, to defend the honor of the village and to make sure that other children don't do the same thing to their parents, if that prodigal is coming back, the villagers had to stone him. So the neighbors would recognize this loser, the one who embarrassed all of us, the one who destroyed his father's reputation, is coming back. Bad precedent. We're not accepting him in the village. We better get the stones. And before he reaches the village, we're going to throw all the stones we can at him. What does father do? He sprints. He runs to get to his son before the villagers could do any retribution. And he embraces him. He takes him. And he leads him home. I know you understand that we're speaking here allegorically about God, who meets us and reaches us before we experience people's judgment. Because when you get that, then when you come back and people try to point fingers at you, guess what? You don't care. Because you know God's got you in his embrace, and that's all that matters. But the challenge comes now. Because as he comes, we all know the story. Father kills the fatted calf, and I could tell you stories about that, and gives the ring on his finger and the rope and everything. And there's a party at home. The older brother who works hard comes and hears all this tumult, and he asks, what's going on? And they say, well, your younger brother has returned. And you know his reaction? How does he react? He gets angry. Now, I find it interesting that in the original, the word there for older brother is not just regular word for an older brother. It's the word, and I'm going to pronounce it in Greek because you'll recognize the significance of that word. It's the word presbyteros. Have you heard that word? It's how we call the church elders. It's the word that hints that he probably held an influential position in that village. That older brother was probably one of those respected leaders that when they gathered together in the synagogue and they would open the scroll, they would call on him to do the reading because he was presbyteros. He held a high respect in that community. Because after all, he was the victim. His younger brother took advantage of him. After all, he's the one who stayed by with the father to support and help. Wouldn't we honor him? If he would be part of our community, we would probably have a special pin. Encourager award. Now, I'm not picking up on anyone who received the pin. I'm still hoping for mine one day. I'm just saying that he was an esteemed church leader. And he got angry because the prodigal brother was coming back home. Do you see a problem here? When I read this parable, I wonder that maybe the reason why some prodigals don't come home because it's the older brothers who stay in the house. Because they know that the attitudes in church of the self-righteous people are such that they don't want them to come home. They would rather prodigals stay there and be wasted and be lost. Because if they come home, then those in-house need to share some of the blessings with them. But not God. That's why we sing Amazing Grace. And I tell you, I've done a lot of funerals, probably nearing 200. And I tell you, at the funerals of people who lived questionable life, one song that is always requested to be sung is the, you could guess, Amazing Grace. Because we all know that we need that amazing grace. In our family, there are people who done us wrong. People who have wasted more than we can afford, true or not. I could speak of my family. Do we have in us to accept them back and to throw a party? When a child who's been rebellious and now is wounded and coming home, how do we respond? When the folks who left the church and have not been coming for a decade decide to come back, how do we welcome them? God is that God of unconditional love, and he accepts all no matter what. And I hope that you get this as the main message. But if this would be the main message of God throwing a party for the lost, the parable would stop right there. Are you tracking with me? But we reach only the culmination point. We reach only the middle of the parable. Because the story escalates. There is another lost son right at home who does not know that he's lost. Because look at his attitude. Now, it's the older son's turn to disgrace the father. We've been always focused on the younger disgracing the father, but the story continues to highlight that it's the older one who disgraces the father even more. I'm reading verse 28. But he was angry and would not come in. Therefore, his father came out and pleaded with him. And so he answered and said to his father, look, now do you get that? He doesn't say, dear dad. He doesn't say, respected father. He's so angry that he turns to his father and all he could say is, look, you. I slaved for you all my life and you never threw a party for me. Friends, I wonder if in church we're so much focused on our own works for God's sake that we miss the point that we do not earn any merits with God. That it's all our response to His grace. He counts the credit. He says, how many years I've stayed here serving you, never giving you one moment of grief. But have you ever thrown a party for me and friends? Then this son of yours, notice he does not even call him what? My brother. The son of yours, as if he's son from another mother. The attitude, you see. Then he comes back and notice where he goes next. He's thrown away your money on whores. It's right there in your Bible. Am I making this up? Shows up and you go all out with the feast. Do you realize that in this statement, this brother betrays his own sins? There's pride, there's envy, there's greed, there's anger. Are you getting my point? In him are all seven of these mortal, deadly sins manifest. Not only that, lust is also there. If he would not be jealous of his younger brother getting some, why is he mentioning prostitutes here? Must have been on his mind. I wonder if he sent some spies, some private investigators to track his brothers to see what he's up to. Because father never did. Father did not care. Father simply loves and waits for him to come home. And friends, I'm saying this because there are many people who've been in church, who served as deacons, who served as elders, but have unresolved anger inside, who have not met this gracious, loving God. I wonder about folks who are in church at all times, did not leave the reservation, so to say. Are they really converted? Or are they just hiding? And deep inside, they wish they could go and do that too. Now, I know nobody agrees with that. We're all saints. It never crosses our mind. But I tell you, I've been to a bedside of a dying woman that shocked me for life. Everybody considered her a more righteous person. And she was on her dying bed and she said to me, Pastor, I'm angry. I wasted my life. I said, what do you mean? She says, I never went out partying. I wore no jewelry. 80 plus and she still does not understand the love of God. Now, I want you to think on this because this older brother is also lost because the love is not in him. Father speaks as a son. You don't understand. You are with me all the time and everything that I have is yours. We have to celebrate. This brother of yours was dead and now he's alive. And that keeps the listeners then, and I hope now, on the edge. Will there be a reconciliation? But the story stops right there. Will the older son come and hug the younger brother? There's need for that in every family. There are siblings who are at odds, and everybody's wondering, what would be that moment when one brother comes and hugs another? The question is open to all of us, older brothers and sisters in the house. How do we respond? Do we carry on angry on the prodigals? Or do we party with them? Because I have this simple message: Jesus gets us. This past Sunday, during Super Bowl, they played a video ad, and it really hit the nerve. Everybody on both sides are talking about it. Left and right, everybody's talking about the ad, how appropriate or inappropriate it was. But it simply communicated this: Jesus gets us. Let's play that short video clip.
Don't ask me what you know is true. Don't have to tell you. I love your precious heart. I was standing, you were there. Two worlds collided, and they could never tear us apart. We can live.
You know what the biggest criticism is? We don't need the reminder. Excuse me? We don't need the reminder that Jesus gets us? Now, I need a reminder. I need to start writing shorter sermons. So I'm going to leave the rest of the sermon for next time. I'm going to dive a bit deeper into this. But I just wanted to tell you a story. The problem of the older brother is that he does not care about father's happiness. All he cares for getting the benefits for himself. And see, that's why he doesn't want to party with the father. A story comes to my mind as the praise team comes to lead us in this song. Because I'm going to make an appeal. In my 8 years here, I haven't made many appeals, but this time I will make an appeal. A story comes about Salieri. Have you heard of that composer? Great composer, Salieri. He makes a deal with God and says, God, I'm going to be chaste. I'm going to be righteous. I'm going to slave for you. I'm going to do everything and more. Just make me the greatest composer. And for a period, he is. But then on a stage comes this younger composer, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Have you heard of him? And he's unruly, promiscuous, a mess. And yet he's a better composer. His middle name is Amadeus, which means loved by God. And Salieri gets so angry with God that he prays and says, God, the deal is over. I hate you. Makes me wonder if some righteous people work for God and think that they will get something more and better deal for themselves from God, who loves all without reservation. So my appeal is simple. Knowing that God loved us while still sinners, God loves us even in our sins. If there's someone in this house who knows they've been an older brother and they held a grudge, and they may even been a bit bitter about some of these prodigals out there, just stand. Don't come up. The rest of you may just close your eyes. Don't look around who's standing, who's sitting. I'm standing already because I've been bitter and I have my grudges. Not gonna tell you stories. If you, an older brother, and you realize that you are not ready to welcome those prodigals and throw a party for them and welcome them and love them without reservation, just take a stand. If you've been a prodigal, spending God's grace unnecessary out there, and you need to come home for God to rob you with the robe of righteousness. Please stand. God is seeing our hearts, because God Himself is a prodigal God. This song we're going to sing right now, "Lord, I'm Coming Home," I wanted to reflect on deep words of this song as the praise team leads us.
Coming home.
better than the snow. Lord, I'm coming home.
Let us pray. Indeed, Lord, our Father in heaven, your love is prodigal. Though we always come short, your love is unchanging. That even though we constantly hurt you, your love remains extravagant. Forgive us, O Father, of our unfaithfulness. Thank you for your mercy and grace. As we make our way home, help us be reminded of our lavish love of gifting us Jesus, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
And before we go home, I just wanted to remind everyone, maybe you found a cell phone. There's someone that lost his cell phone. Can you please just forward it to the deacon's office? Thank you.
Service for Jesus, your